social event of the year. Well, we're here today to have another fish social event of the year, different year, but the same kind of thing, bringing a bunch of us together for, I think, a really good reason. And that is to hear Gerald Smith talk about the fish future of the Great Lakes fish community. I want to talk a little bit about Gerald because I've known him for a long time. He actually was on the search committee that hired me back in 1979. So if you think I'm old, he's older. And he was actually great because I came here not knowing much about Michigan, and he connected me up with the Museum of Zoology, which has just been a great group. I think a lot of people here don't really realize the amazing people that have worked there. I didn't get to work with Carl Hubbs, but I did Bob Miller, Reed Bailey, Jerry, of course, Bill Gosline, Bill Fink, just an amazing group of people working on important things for us. Important things for us, important things for the world, and for the state of Michigan. The museum not only is involved in sort of systematics and understanding evolution of fishes, but also in educating people about fishes, which is a big part of what we're hoping to do today. I had a kind of an interesting first experience with Jerry. I don't know if he remembers this, but somehow or other, we were doing a study on lake sturgeon up in the Black River, and the DNR was going to come out and collect eggs to spawn fish and do all that. And they had closed off the dam so that the water would go down, and all the sturgeon ran and hid in this big hole, and none of them came out. After about 2 hours, the DNR guys all got up and left and sort of thought, well, this isn't going to work. And Jerry kind of came over to me and says, you know, I think we could chase those fish out of that hole and go ahead and catch them. And sure enough, I can't remember what we used. I think it was a rope or electric cord or something. But we managed to chase the fish out and get them. And then, for some reason, the DNR had advertised this thing. And so there were a lot of people there. In my mind, there were like 200 people there. And I was going to surgically implant a transmitter in that fish. One of the fish, and I was afraid because we hadn't actually had a live sturgeon to play with before. And so I'm just picturing, yeah, I'm going to cut this hole in the fish. It's going to die right here in front of 200 people. And Jerry managed to convince me that I wouldn't fail, and I didn't. The fish at least swam off. I don't know how long it lived, but at least it swam away, which made me feel really good. My second story about Jerry kind of relates to that. The museum has always been a kind of an interesting place because when somebody catches a really big or unique fish, it comes to the museum for identification. So every once in a while, you'll wander into the fish division and they'll have something there. And the one I remember was a Atlantic salmon that was here. And it had been identified as a state record brown trout. I think I got that right. And actually, it was kind of funny because the person who identified it, who was another Michigan DNR employee, I'm not trying to pick on the DNR, it's just easy. But anyway, had an interaction with somebody, and a sports fisherman was there when they caught this fish and was showing it to the DNR guy and saying, I think it's an Atlantic salmon. And the DNR guy said, no, it's a brown trout. He says, I'm pretty sure it's an Atlantic salmon. And he says, no, it's a brown trout. And he, same thing again, and then finally the DNR guy says, we don't need any more of you tennis shoe biologists telling us what's the brown trout. You know? So sure enough, came to the museum, and it was an Atlantic salmon. And it was not a state record, and it kind of created a lot of interesting interactions. Anyway, so today we're here to celebrate the publication of a new book that was done by Jerry. And actually, from that point of view, Jerry has been great. I remember talking to him several times before he retired, and yeah, I'm going to write the Fishes of Michigan, and yeah, I'm going to do the Great Lakes Fishes, and none of that ever really happened. And then all of a sudden he retired, and this came out, and a couple years later, the new Great guy, not the guide, but the Fishes of the Great Lakes came out with his edition, and then this came out. So all you have to do is retire, and you get a lot more done than before retirement. I'm Jim Diana, for those who don't know, and I'm the director of Michigan Sea Grant. And Sea Grant has been involved with communicating, educating, and doing research on the Great Lakes, or facilitating that, for a long time, since about as long as I've been a faculty member, even longer. And the people from the museum, and particularly Jerry, have been involved with that all along. They have supported this work for many years. We have programs like Fisheries Learning on the web, and they've always been reviewing the programs, helping us with identification guides and anything that has to do with fishes. It's been a really nice interaction where we can just depend on getting good quality information and feedback from people like Jerry. And before I started at Seagram, I hope I was in that category too. Now I'm on the asking end rather than the telling end. So this Guide to Great Lakes Fishes is kind of the reason we're here to celebrate. And it was something done jointly between Jerry, Sea Grant, and the U of M Press. The funding for it was provided partly by NOAA, partly by the U of M Press, and partly by Jerry himself, which kind of indicates how important he thought this was. I think the cost of having waterproof pages was what Jerry ended up paying for instead of everybody else. Kind of, I don't know why Sea Grant didn't pay for it, Jerry. We'll have to ask that later. Didn't have any more money? That's right. It was either your pages or my salary, was that it? Very nice.
The work.
Thanks. Yeah, the check's in the mail. And talking about the work of this book, illustrations were done by Emily Damster, and it's a beautifully illustrated book. If you haven't looked at it yet, first time I picked it up, it just struck me, and I'm sure it strikes all of you. And the nice part, the waterproof pages, because if you look at any of my identification keys that I've either loaned to students or taken out in the field myself, they're all falling apart. And it's really nice to have something that won't fall apart. Todd Marsay from Sea Grant did a lot of the illustrations, the diagrammatic illustrations. And Elizabeth Laporte did a lot of coordination to get this done between Jerry, Sea Grant, Todd, and everybody else involved. And of course, Jerry put the effort into doing all this. Anyway, in celebration of the publication of this, and we do have more outside to sell if you would like to get some, Jerry's going to give a talk to us today on the future of the Great Lakes fish community. So, Professor Jerry Smith.
Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you, Jim. It's an honor to be here to talk to you about the future of the Great Lakes, especially at this time when the Great Lakes are so much in the news, as they should be. This little field guide project started as a kind of volunteer project with Elizabeth Laporte to create a guide that whose goal was to somehow increase public awareness of Michigan fish. So as to perhaps get people a little bit more involved with some of the conservation issues involved in the Great Lakes, because this is so important to us. And I want this occasion to be a general discussion. We have a lot of really sharp Great Lakes people here, and I hope we can get a general discussion of some of the current issues and some of the things we have to be involved with. So that's why we turned the what was sort of thought of as a book promotion incident into a general discussion of Great Lakes conservation issues. And so I'll talk a little bit about the past history of Great Lakes and with help from some of you, some of the possibilities for the future of Great Lakes and the fish communities and the fisheries.